Good morning. Hello, I'm Vincent Ball, and I'm a reporter with The Expositor. As part of our election coverage, we're interviewing all of the candidates for mayor, and today I have with me John Trammell. Mr. Trammell is a graduate of the Electrical Engineering program at Carleton University and has been a resident of Brantford for about the past 10 or 11 years. He has the distinction of being in the Guinness Book of World Records for running in elections. He ran in the Ontario provincial election earlier this year, losing to incumbent Dave Labatt, and is now running for mayor of Brantford. Welcome.
And in the Trinity Spadina by-election federally, so that was my third political hat trick of being registered in three separate levels simultaneously.
Oh, wow.
1980, 1982, and this year, three simultaneous elections, 80, 81, and 82.
Okay, that's got to be something. You must have been running pretty hard that year.
Well, all years, when there's an opening, it just flukes that there were three that happened right now. The Brant Provincial General, then the Trinity Spadina Federal opened up, and then I registered for mayor, and that was three simultaneous.
I've got to ask you, back, what, well, it's probably more than 20
years ago. 1979.
Okay, but in the early 80s, you had some run-ins with the law with respect to gambling.
Yes, I was a proponent for legalized casinos for many years.
Tell me a little bit about how that came about, what happened.
Well, I was the teaching assistant of Canada's only mathematics and gambling course.
Okay.
And I learned that blackjack could be beaten like poker.
Uh-huh.
And if poker was okay, if it was a fair game, why couldn't I do it? So I started running underground games.
Okay.
And letting other people be the bank.
Right.
Ottawa's Gambling Crusaders. But then I got busted. And they simply convicted me for being better than the other guys. And once I had a criminal record, well, then it was full-time underground gambling. And then it was, you know, the media used to joke in Ottawa, my cell at the Ottawa police station had a revolving door.
Oh, is that right?
So, about 8 or 9 raids took place over those years. But finally, it's legal. And in...
Well, that's what I want to ask you about. What do you think when you go through the province, and you can travel anywhere in this province, and you go down 403, 401, and you're going to see a sign, OLG slots here, OLG slots there.
Wonderful.
What are you thinking about that now? I mean, well,
I know
the trouble that you had.
Well, there were a lot of old prohibitions that are going to come down. I'm fighting to legalize marijuana.
Mm-hmm.
I have actions in the federal court with 275 self-defenders, sick people. One just died while his action for an exemption was stayed. And so I have many fights for marijuana. There's another prohibition that's got to come down, especially after Fukushima. We've been sucking in fallout for 3 years now. And anyway, we're going to need marijuana oil and juice, not necessarily the bud to get high, but the plant products to kill the cancers. And so I'm an advocate for repeal, and I hope to have action in federal court within the next month to do just that. And I have 26 cases in the Court of Appeal and 1, 2, 3, 4 in the Supreme Court right now, all on marijuana charges. People fighting back saying we got a right to our medicine. So those kind of prohibitions are coming down. Gambling is coming down. I came here in 03, the general election provincial, to run.
Okay.
Because, you know, in Ottawa, I wasn't going to get on the debates, and I couldn't win there. So I said, I'll come and run here and play poker at your new little casino. And it was beautiful, charming, well run, so I stayed.
Okay.
And so I live 3 blocks away, and that's where I go play when I want to.
Can somebody
biggest game in Canada.
Can somebody make a decent living playing poker at the casino in Brantford?
Well,
but they'll get you revealing.
Yeah.
But I want to know.
Well, I'm sure there are some. Yes, there are some young professionals who manage to take home a living wage.
Is that right?
Yeah.
And how about you?
Yeah, I'm the best.
You're the best.
Yeah, I was known as the professor at the Taj Mahal in Atlantic City. You ever see Rounders? See the big shot at the Taj Mahal with the chandeliers?
Mm-hmm.
I was known as the professor at that Taj Mahal because I was the teaching assistant at Canada's only mathematics gambling course. So every town's got their professor in the local game who knows the odds.
Mm-hmm.
But I was the professor at the Taj.
You had the debate the other night.
Yeah.
And you know that there's been a lot of press coverage about the Market Square Mall sale.
Yeah.
To Laurier Brantford. And you've probably been following the growth of Laurier in the downtown. You would have been down there a long time. What do you think of the deal?
Well, I mean, sounds good to me. What else are you going to do with it? It's right in the middle where they need it. So wonderful. That's all I can say. It seems like it's going to fit right in. They need a student activity open area anyway, and they finally got one.
Okay.
So it seems good to me. But, I mean, a lot of those students are broke, have not that much money. And I want to give them a chance. Now we're going to talk about alternate currencies.
Okay, you want to talk about that? Go ahead for a couple minutes and then we'll move on.
Okay, there are three angles here. Last municipal election, I wanted to pay kids with bus bucks, bus credits, put them on their bus cards. Mm-hmm. And I, you know, interviewed dozens and dozens and dozens of kids, said, would you work and shovel snow next winter for bus bucks? And they all went, yeah, except one. And so my point is that we're going to have probably a very bad winter coming up because the climate warming hoaxers who used the trick to hide the decline in the temperature we've now felt for the last 16 years, and I'm betting it's going to get worse. So I would love to have a gang of kids organized to shovel the snow when the plows go by for bus tickets. Now, didn't make it through last election, but Hong Kong paid their students with their bus credits the year after. So it's been done before, and that's a way of mobilizing a whole bunch of kids, especially poor kids, into being able to contribute something really useful when we really need it. I mean, if they're going to have to call off all the schools, why shouldn't the kids be out there shoveling and making bus bucks?
We had a guy last night at the Ward 1 debate saying that he should set aside $200,000 of city money to send kids to Mohawk College, from here to Mohawk College. What do you think? Bus bucks or money from the city?
Well, I mean, they're all given the chance to also earn bus bucks, mm-hmm. doing something.
Right.
Well, they may need less cash, and we can have more kids sent to Mohawk.
Okay.
So bus bucks can always contribute by freeing up some cash, right?
Okay.
So that's basically it. But I mean, we have an almost infinite supply of empty bus seats. I mean, kids could be packing them, mm-hmm. you know, mm-hmm. but we're getting our snow shoveled. And when you're getting my age, you don't want to be out there humping your buns, you know, mm-hmm. and seeing a bunch of kids on the corner doing nothing useful. Mm-hmm. Now, I had a press clipping at the debate where I showed old man shoveling snow dies in Hamilton. I was waiting, is this going to happen in Brantford? It doesn't have to. I mean, it could be organized so quickly, and you could have kids shoveling their own yards first. Daddy, if you want your kids getting paid bus tickets to shovel your driveway first, and they could be organized to shovel the driveways where people are leaving earlier. So it's easily organized, and we have the underground currency with bus tickets to do that. So that's the angle for the youth. Now, one lady said, my husband will work for 12 bus bucks an hour in the videos. JohnTurmel.com/busbucks and has all the videos. And now, the other angle was used in Argentina. Same kind of thing. But instead of being backed up with bus rides, mm-hmm. bond bucks. If the city can issue $1 million bond to a bank to get bills, spend it, tax it out with interest, mm-hmm. why can't they print up $1 million $10 bonds, spend it, tax it out, no interest? So in Argentina, when they were broke, six state provinces were forced to do that. The unions insisted, actually. Mm-hmm. Said, no layoffs, pay us with small denomination bonds if we can use them for hydro, taxes, medical, and licenses.
Basic stuff.
And everybody will want these. Okay. Now, Ontario would be great Ontario bonds because they got hydro, medical, taxes, and licenses. Mm-hmm. So, but Brantford, too. Municipal services, bus rides, they would be bonds work on, okay. you know. So I'm saying that people working for the municipality could be given a bonus and part of their pay in bonds instead of cash. And that allows more cash to be distributed. Having to pay interest to use it.
Okay.
That's the only difference between printing our own local currency and using the government's bank currency is that they authorize the banks to loan shark it to us. Mm. And to avoid the vigorous, the loan shark fees, smart communities are setting up their own bond buck systems. Okay. Now in Russia, when their system crashed in 1990s, and by crash I mean they tell you your bank's no good no more, you can't get your money out no more. Corralito in Argentina, can't get your money no more. Mm-hmm. What are you going to do? Well, people started going to the barter fairs and using their small little tickets. Now, that's the third angle now, babysitting bucks. If you go to johnturmel.com/unilets, I now explain how you can do DIY P2P money. And I bet that's going to be the biggest revolution in history. Mm-hmm. When anybody can make their own, do it yourself, person to person money. Now,
is that a barter system?
Yes. Time barter. Global, though. Mm. When I went to Europe, I paid for 39 nights out of 40 with an IOU for a night back in Canada. Mm-hmm. With 5 hours between countries. In France, they pay themselves 60 green time francs an hour. In Germany, it's 20 time marks. In Britain, 6 time pounds. The States, 10 time dollars. And in Canada, 12. But between countries, we trade hours. So after my trip, I owed them 195 hours, 39 nights. For the 40 I didn't have to pay cash for. And of course, everybody knows I can put people up or find someone who will. So, but here's the point. That's all registered in my online account, my time barter account. But then I said, you know, Argentina, they always had problem with counterfeiting when they had these big, big 7 million member barter clubs. And they had big serial numbers and stuff. And I said, if you run a local currency, why not simply use your own? Now, it's checking it out, the money. Now, if you have a Facebook ID, like I do, I went and posted at my Facebook ID that I printed myself up $700 in time dollars. Because I don't want to have to go record on my account, I owe you 2 hours because you drove me to Toronto and back. But I would rather give you a 2 hour bill. Same ID with babysitting now. This allows a babysitting network to swap nights when they babysit each other's kids, freeing up the other ones, and they pay each other with 1 hour bills. So, in Canada, it's 12 time dollars, which is the reason I offered 12 to the kids. All volunteers get 12, doctors can have 80, whatever, dentists, higher numbers of time dollars. It's regular commerce, but it's a time-based money, local, instead of the government's federal money. Now, point is this, I made one up for you, but I got, this is mine. And here's how I put my money into circulation. Now, I made you up a series of $700.
Okay.
You can't spend it until you sign it because it's an IOU for time you owe. But if a buddy comes over and helps you move, you can sign him 2 4-hour IOUs and say, I'll help you later, give it back.
Okay.
All right? So, but then it allowed, there's a template at Unilad's site, which allows anybody to go and print up their own time dollars with their name with their Facebook ID on it.
Okay.
So your Facebook ID's on there.
So how do you...
Now, wait a minute now. Once you decide you're going to start issuing your IOUs in our network, who will take it, you got to go to your Facebook page and announce, I've just issued 700 of my own poker chips. Acceptable in our local casino. Now, your poker chips are like traveler's checks. As soon as you sign them, you owe.
Okay.
Now, I go do accordion concerts in old folks' homes. Amber Lee, Riverview, John Noble, Hardy Terrace, Tranquility. That's how I practice or I'd never play. Okay? And but what I do is when I go there, I make them sign me. These things say, I owe / thank. Well, if I'm given a credit up front and serving my community, I scratch out the I owe, and then some lady witness signs, John Turmel played his accordion for all these old people at John Noble yesterday, and for 2 hours or 1 hour or whatever. Now here's my point, that is now a useful piece of currency, like an IOU to babysit in the future. So you might say that this is already performed service money.
Okay.
And if you got any old friends in any old folks towns in Brantford, I probably made them happy. So you're really gonna think my 1 hour bill wasn't backed up with productive service? That's my point. So if a kid wants to clean
a
park.
What would you cash that in for? What would you get?
Well, a 1 hour bill from babysitter.
Okay.
It's all based on time.
Okay.
And if I put, I'm getting 1.5 hours for 1.5 hour concert, though if I were to play outside for somebody, I'd probably charge them 5 hours an hour, like
so
a pro.
So somebody is in there,
yeah,
and you perform that service, you play the accordion for an hour and a half or whatever, and you get an hour and a half back. And maybe one of those people has somebody who's got a moving company. They can say, hey, check him out, you can get an hour and a half of moving, or lifting, or carrying, or whatever.
Well, I could say, hey, your mama's in that home, would you take my hour and a half to replace $18 in my $200 bill?
Okay.
And he'll probably say, yeah, you played for my grandma, I'll take that as an $18 bill.
But isn't the issue with that, though, that a lot of people do this for volunteer, and they get a nice feeling for doing it.
Yeah, but they still get the feeling, but every volunteer can do what I did. I went and recorded the thousands of hours I've played in the past, over the last 50 years. And I just, like, you work for SPCA. You put in 20 hours a week for 10 years. I met a lady like that. I said, just go to your Facebook page, announce that you put in 10,000 hours for the Humane Society in your community, and you want to be able to spend your five-hour bills when you travel. And guess what? All the other Humane Society volunteers who posted their numbers are going to take your bills.
Could this concept be used? You know that paid downtown on-street parking is a bit of an issue.
Yeah.
It came up and it's been deferred and they've been talking about it and all kinds of information out there. Could this be used for the downtown parking problem? And how would you apply it to it?
I think we'd probably have more buses. With a lot better bus service, because so many more people will be riding them if a lot of people are wanting bus bucks. It's a way for the city to cover the snow getting done, and the money they don't spend there, they can spend on buying more buses.
Mm-hmm.
So, with more public, like my goal in my heart has always been free public transport. If
okay.
we can subsidize 80, why can't we subsidize 100 and make getting out of your car really worthwhile and optimizing? So, I mean, but with the bus bucks, look, Ontario Hydro could have paid for all of their operations with Ontario Hydro bucks, because in 1993, North York issued $25 Hydro gift certificates.
How do you see that? How do you wean a generation off of cash, though? I mean,
no, this is still cash.
Mm-hmm.
I got videos at the Unilad site where you got the kids in Argentina going woo 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 in these big barter markets where everybody takes their credits.
Mm-hmm.
And the deal is, like the guy says, we're not like the IMF where we lend you 100, say give us back 150. We lend you 100 and say give us back 100 in goods and services to the network. That's the deal.
Mm-hmm.
And everybody goes, well, that sounds fair. And that's the deal.
Boundary negotiations between Brantford and Brant County. You've probably been following a little
yeah,
bit about that.
Not much. Why? Because in 2010, no solution. In 07, no solution. When I got here, they were arguing the same thing. Right?
Okay.
So, there's
you're
no...
You're a poker player. You know negotiations. You
yeah.
know human nature.
Yeah.
You know human nature. It's not just mathematical.
I know. My answer is two guys with not enough chips are both going to be stingy. And
okay.
two guys with enough chips can come to a better deal. That's my point. Now, my point was always the more of the community, like I heard 1.5 extra million in interest this year on city's budget, extra. Now I don't even know what the real number is, but hey, what's wrong with getting rid of that and saving it? So every one of these you use liberates up cash at the bank and saves interest, so you can then use the cash to pay an extra employee. So, like I say, the only people think and local currencies are accused of being tax evasion systems. They're not, but they're interest evasion systems, okay? That's the only thing we save, really, is the interest, and we maximize economic activity, because no matter how poor you are, you can watch someone's dog or watch someone's plants.
You can do something.
And you can read to a blind person. You can do something.
Mm-hmm.
You just gotta start doing it and getting a 1 hour in bill in response
mm-hmm.
to keep doing it. Now,
how
that's,
popular are you with banks?
Pardon?
How popular are you with banks?
I just wanna reprogram their software so that people pay a one-time service charge. They can still do all the regular stuff they do, evaluating and business, you know, values and stuff, but no more foreclosure department.
Okay.
Here's how it would work if it were run with poker chips. You want to buy that house.
Mm-hmm.
You're fresh out of school. You tell the banker, hey, I need 100,000 chips for that house. He goes, okay, give me your marker. I give it to him. He goes, buys the house.
Yeah.
Now the house is backing up the marker, not the kid. Right?
Okay. Right.
Now I just say, I want you to pay me as fast as the house depreciates, so that the house backing up the chips always matches up the chips. That's basically how it would work if we got an interest-free account at the Bank of Canada.
Reverse mortgages.
It's the same idea. You're putting up your collateral and spending against it, but you're paying interest. I just want to do the same without it. Your house would be your kind of a bank. I happen to have a $200,000 house and half of it's paid off. Wow, you're worth 100 G's in only 5 years. You're a winner. So with no interest, your house becomes kind of like your collateral bank. But you have an open credit line against it to use against, and even go more against your time credit line. So Isaiah 55, you who have no money and are hungry, come buy and eat. And how do you buy with no money? Credit's okay. Lend it. Don't give it. And then hope they give it back, but don't chase. And Jesus said it best. Lend unto others as you would have them lend unto you. Interest free.
Got one more question for you. Is Brantford ready for poker playing mayor?
is Brantford ready for the ultimate winner? Like I told the kids during the student vote, look at you two, Termel, I said, look, this is game theory. Who's going to disagree with me when I say, hey, we've got a chance of winning one way over here out of 10 and two ways over there out of 10? I'm going two. You want to stand up and disagree with my math? So I said, when I say something's a winner, it's because I figured it out. Who's going to disagree? So what's wrong with having a little high-tech intellectual science? But this ain't high-tech. I mean, it's been done before. It's a political issue. People just can't believe something so simple as your own IOU being accepted in your hometown being a real piece of money. But now it is. And I say DIY P2P money is going to be the greatest liberation revolution in history, and you're the first interview I've ever done telling about it.
The casino is one of your best spots. What's the next best thing about Brantford after the casino?
Well, the parks. A lot of nice parks, well taken care of. No threats, no feeling of fear when you're going through town. I've had a wonderful 11 years. I love it. So I live in one of the old Brant mansions, 10-foot high ceilings. I flew getting after I was expropriated from the slum, where I had a beautiful view over the river. King of the Paupers lives anywhere, but same landlord, so I'm now in a wonderful spot. It's not like I want to get in to be mayor so I can pick which projects we spend money on when I got enough for all of them, right? I just want to get in to fix it, and then you probably won't see me around very much.
Okay. I think that's it. I can't think of anything else I'd like to talk, but thank you so much for doing this. I appreciate your time.
Good stuff. Good interview. So, there you go.
I always get nervous with technology. I always got to check my mic 6 times to make sure that it's on.
If you ever want to participate in one of our... Oh, there's an instruction manual at the end there. It's my Unilets page. But if you ever want to participate, all you got to do is announce, I'm putting my chips into circulation backed by my time. And if I go to a flea market, I'll bring stuff to back up my IOUs. But everybody who goes to a flea market basically uses their own credits now. Like these in Russia, they used to have flash flea markets. Everybody would show up at one big empty lot with trunk clothes, and one guy came along with the coupons. They needed for chips.
Right.
Same in Argentina. But we've a little, the counterfeit story. There's only going to be, you might only issue $21. Oh, when I picked up a piece of steel off the road, to avoid, I stopped my car, got out, picked up a big jagged piece of steel, I gave myself a one-time dollar tip.
Yeah,
you understand? Yeah. That's another community, but I witnessed my own. But I don't mind doing that. I'm not going to lie over $1, right?
Yeah.
But I'm saying everything you can do to help your community can count, and you can witness it yourself. And if you're lucky enough to have someone else to witness it, it becomes a positive against your negatives for me.